والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome to a new episode of Correct Your Citation. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Praise be to Allah alone, I praise him and I seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Dear viewers everywhere, once again, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Similarly, our guests here at the studio, how are you all? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa
rahmatullahi. Once again, for the second time, we're hosting Brother Ali from the USA, Halim and Shindi. Assalamu alaikum, all of you.
Alaikum.
Inshallah, we'll begin this segment. We're resuming the tafsir and the interpretation of verse number 49 of Surah Al-Kahf. This is where we stopped at. It was not done completely in the last episode. We ran out of time. So let me recite the verse, then inshallah learn its English meaning and the tafsir as well. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ووضع الكتاب فترى المجرمين مشفقين مما فيه ويقولون يا ويلتنا ويقولون يا ويلتنا ما لهذا الكتاب لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها ووجدوا ما عملوا حاضرا ولا يظلم ربك أحدا. In this verse, Allah the Almighty says what it means, and the book, and we said the book he refers to everyone's record, whether good or bad. One's record will be placed, and you will see the criminals fearful of that which is recorded therein, which is basically their deeds, the harvest of what they used to do. Mm-hmm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not add to their deeds, their bad deeds, an art. It is just the horrible scene of how much sins they've committed, it will scare them to death. They will say, upon seeing that, woe to us, ya waylatana, ya waylatana, woe to us, ma li hadha al-kitab la yughadiru saghiratan wala kabiratan illa ahsaha. What sort of book is this that leaves neither a small thing nor a big thing, but has recorded it with numbers? And they will find all that they did placed before them, and your Lord treats no one with injustice. وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning us, all of us. I warn you, and I warn myself and all Muslims, whenever we read and recite the Quran, whether the verses are pertaining the children of Israel, are pertaining any nation following any prophet, that we have to consider that Allah is addressing us as well. Yeah. You should not say, well, He's addressing them, not us. The issue of the book being placed on the Day of Judgment is not only their book, but every person's book, every person's record. And this warning means to prepare for this moment. In order to be delighted and happy upon receiving your record in your right hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمْقَرَأُوا كِتَابِيَهِ إِنِّي ظَنَنْتُ أَنِّي مُلَاقٍ حِسَابِيَهِ فَهُوَ فِي عِيشَةٍ رَضِيَةٍ فِي جَنَّةٍ عَالِيَةٍ. He's referring to one who will receive his record in his right hand. He will call on every person, because all of us will be resurrected, as we stated in the last episode, in one plane. No one can hide. So he will call on every person. Halim say, "Ha umqaw kitabiyah." He wants everyone, everyone, from the very first to the very last, to come forward to look in his record. That reminds us with whenever we were in high school and we are waiting for report cards for the results, when one is have scored big scores, he's very proud of himself and he shows it to every person, right? Mm-hmm. But when one fails, he's trying to hide and conceal. He turns his cell phone off. He doesn't speak to anyone. Why? His shine off. That if he's a person who really is ashamed of his failure, on the day of judgment, there is a bigger scale. The successful ones will call on every person to come and look in their record. He says that, this is what I believe. I believe that there will be a day of judgment. There will be a day of assessment and accountability. And that's why I have prepared for it. فهو ملاق حسابي. Accordingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compense him with what's good, with what's better. فهو في عيشة الراضية في جنة عالية, the eternal happiness and delight in paradise and so forth. Pertaining the one who receives his record in his left hand, the wrongdoers, the disbelievers, the rebellious ones, فَيَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أُوتَ كِتَابِيَ. I wish that I did not receive my book. I did not see it. I wish I was not even resurrected. وَلَمْ أَدْرِ مَا حِسَابِيَ. I wish I did not know anything about this moment, about accountability. يَا لَيْتَهَا كَانَتِ الْقَاضِيَةِ. I wish death was the last station and there will not be any resurrection afterward. But this is not the case. One of the articles of faith is to believe in the day of recompense, which will require you to believe in what, Halim? In accountability. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, في سورة آل عمران, يوم تجد كل نفس ما عملت من خير محضرا وما عملت من سوء تود لو أن بينها وبينه أمدا بعيدا. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a close look at that on the day of judgment, when the books will be presented before every person, then كل نفس, every person will find whatever they've done of good or bad presented in the record. But as far as what was done wrong, evil doing, major sins, then that person will say and would wish that there is a great distance between him and his record. He's trying to escape his record. He doesn't want to take it. يَوَدُّ لَوْ أَنَّ بَيْنَهُ وَمَا عَمِلَتْ مِنْ سُوءٍ تَوَدُّ لَوْ أَنَّ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَهُ أَمَدًا بَعِيدًا وَيُحَذِّرُكُمُ اللَّهُ نَفْسَهُ. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sealed this verse with a remark. He says, وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا, that your Lord does not wrong no one, does not treat no one with injustice. Rather, this is your record, contains your deeds, whether good or bad. With regards to the good, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ. Indeed, Allah does not wrong any person, even an atom weight of injustice. No way. وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً يُضَاعِفْهَا. He does not treat us with just justice. Rather, he treats us with mercy and generosity. So with regards to the good deeds, إِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً, if there is a single good deed, Allah will multiply the reward for it. يُضَاعِفْهَا وَيُؤْتِ مِنْ لَدُنْهُ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. And he gives out of his bounty a great reward without limit. For instance, if we examine one parable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drew forth في سورة البقرة, concerning giving in a charity. He said, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلَ فِي كُلِّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةُ حَبَّةٍ وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Can you imagine one single seed producing 700 grains? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that one single hasana one charity, a dollar, a dinar, a dirham that you give, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep doubling and multiplying the reward for it up to 700 times. And there is even more, since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ, way beyond the 700 times, to whomever He wills. So, when it comes to good deeds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives manifold reward, without limit. But when it comes to sins, then He treats you with justice. He said, عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, by the end of Surah Al-An'am, مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا وَمَنْ جَاءَ بِالسَّيِّئَةِ
فَلَا يُجْزَى
إِلَّا مِثْلَهَا. Whoever does a single good deed, he shall receive 10 times therein. The like of what he's done will be deposited to his credit thereof. And one who does a single bad deed, his recompense for this sin will be only one recompense. One sayyi'ah. It will not be recorded against him two or three or four. Justice is one of the traits of the most just, our Lord, Allah the Almighty. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, on the day of judgment, we understand that those who will be held accountable are humans and the jinn, because they are responsible to answer the prophets, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willingly, different than animals, different than plants, fruits and vegetations, different than the mountains, heavens and the earth, different than the angels, who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unwillingly. That's why there is no such accountability for them on the day of judgment. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in one hadith that يُقْتَصُ لِلشَّاةِ الْعَجْمَاءِ مِنَ الْقَرْمَاءِ What does it mean? On the day of judgment, a sheep or a ram that had horns in the life of this world and have used these horns to hurt another innocent sheep, on the day of judgment, both of whom will be resurrected. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the sheep which did not have horns, a couple of horns, in order to take its right from the transgressor sheep or ram. That's why many of the companions, including Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, used to wish that I wish that I was just a sheep. Because on the day of judgment, sheep and animals will not suffer the fear of might entering the fire of hell. Rather, there will be equality in punishment, then they will turn into dust. And this is it for them. But for us as humans and for the jinn as well, there is either one of two places, an eternal delight in heaven or an eternal suffering in the fire of hell. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take all of us to His paradise by His mercy. Yes, Muhammad.
Sheikh, this sheep hadith, does it refers to everything is going to be determined and just like example or...
Whenever the Prophet ﷺ said that, it does not refer to a single sheep or a single camel or a single animal, but it's covering the system of justice that every oppressor, including animals, on the day of judgment will be treated likewise. So this is as far as the animals. But for the humans, there is a different scale. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised us that if there is a mazlama, if you have wronged anyone in this life, then ask him to forgive you. Render back his money to him or his amana, or apologize to him before a day will come. On the day there will not be neither dirham nor a dinar. There is no settlement for money. The settlement will be from your own good deeds. So imagine a person like Hitler on the day of judgment coming before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while he had killed hundreds of thousands of people. Imagine George Bush coming on the day of judgment after invading a sovereign country and being the sole cause of the death and the dislocation of hundreds of thousands of families. What are you going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Such person should really regret and repent unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before everybody, and beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness before the day will come when there will be justice, the ultimate justice. وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. The following verse is tapping another new story. We already studied the story of the people of the cave, the youth, Halim.
Yeah.
Then we studied another story, which is the story of
the two men.
The two men, the one who was rich and the other was poor. And the rich was a disbeliever, while the poor was a believer. And we learned the fate of each one of them. Then in this story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us with the eternal enmity between us and our plain and open opponent, which is
Satan.
Yeah. He says, Azza wa Jal, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّهِ أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِنْ دُونِي وَهُمْ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ بِئْسَ لِلظَّالِمِينَ بَدَلًا. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us with the original story of the enmity and animosity between us and Satan, Halim. When did it begin and how did it start? وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ. Allah the Almighty is using the pronoun of the single who is glorifying himself. Yeah. We. Remember when we said to the royal we. Remember when we said to the angels. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was addressing al-malaika. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ تِسْجُدُوا لِآدَمْ. The word sujood could mean prostration or bowing down. The sujood should be only to
Allah
the Almighty. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I was commanding any person to bow down or to prostrate himself or herself before another, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would have commanded the wife to bow down out of respect to her husband, not out of worship. So bowing down or prostrating oneself out of worship is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and before the Lord. Bowing down before any other creature is considered an act of shirk. But in this case, it is Allah Himself who ordered the angels to bow down to Adam, whom He created by His own hands, in order to greet him, not to worship. In order to magnify him, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created every living creature by saying, kun, and it was. But with regard to Adam alayhi salam, he formed him out of mud by his own hand. Then he breathed the soul into him by himself. And this is how he honored Adam alayhi salam and his offspring. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in the Quran. Well, فَسَجَدُوا. They all bow down before Adam alayhi salam in order to greet him. And in order to worship Allah by obeying Him in His command, except for one. This word except is a little bit problematic. Why?
Yeah.
Because when I say that all the guests have arrived except a camel. Well, I did not invite a camel. But when you say all the angels were commanded to bow down to Adam, they did except Satan. It might give you the impression that Satan was one of the angels, which is false. That's why right away in the same verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ, except for Iblis, since he belonged to al-jinn. And what about al-jinn? Are they different creation? Yes. إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِ. In the hadith, which is sound hadith, collected by Muslim and narrated by Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خُلِقَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ مِنْ نُورِ. The angels were created from
light.
وَخُلِقَ إِبْلِيسُ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارِ. And Satan was created from a smokeless flame. وَخُلِقَ آدَم مِمَّا تَعْلَمُونَ. And Adam was created from whatever you already know. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeatedly stated in the Quran that He created Adam from
clay.
Mud. Clay. Teen. clay, dust, water, because basically if you mix the dust with water, it will produce
mud.
And clay. Mud. Then if this mud is been hardened, it becomes
the clay.
Like pottery. It becomes hard. So all of these descriptions are perfectly fine. This is our origin. Then, of course, we're created from ma'in mahin, which is the semen and the zygote, etc. But Iblis was created from fire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it very clear that Iblis, Satan, was not one of the jinn. He happened to be present. So when they were commanded, and he was left, and they obeyed, they bowed down, except for him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated the command, and he said, مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَكُونَ مَعَ السَّاجِدِينَ. Why didn't you join them? Maybe he misunderstood. Maybe he thought the command was only to the angels. So now he declared his evil intention, his arrogance. The worst sin ever is arrogance. And this is what took Satan out of paradise into the fire of hell eternally. Because he was arrogant. He compared himself to Adam. And he said, خَلَقَتَهُ خَلَقَتَنِي مِن نَارٍ وَخَلَقَتَهُ مِن طِينٍ. How can I bow down to him? Well, I'm superior to him. He created me from fire, and he created him from mud. And fire is superior to mud. So the worst sin is arrogance and jealousy. He envied Adam عليه السلام. That's why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in one hadith, one who has as little as an atom weight of arrogance in his heart shall not enter paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us humble ourselves before him and before the believers. Well, this is it for this segment. And inshallah, in a little bit, we'll return back with a new rule of the rules of Al-Mad. Stay tuned. We'll be back inshallah shortly. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Narrated Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, a man came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and asked, O Allah's Apostle, which charity is the most superior in reward? He replied, the charity which you practice while you are healthy, niggardly and afraid of poverty and wish to become wealthy. Do not delay it to the time of approaching death and then say, give so much to such and such, and so much to such and such. And it has already belonged to such and such, as it is too late. Related by Al-Bukhari.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. In the previous episode, we tackled Maddul Badal, right? Which is in English, al-badal means exchange.
Exchange.
And we call it exchange because we exchange a second hamza, al-hamza sakina, into a mad letter that suits the vowel of the previous hamza. Maddul badal is a very exceptional mad because we're talking about the mad letters preceded by hamza versus al-maddul jaiz al-munfasil, al-maddul wajib al-muttasil, or مد الصلة الكبرى. So in this case, the hamza comes before the mad letters, not after. Okay. And we said there are four cases for this mad. We studied two in the last episode, and inshallah we'll continue. But before we take the second two, I would like to have a quick recap and study the other two as well once again. The first state or case of مد البدل is observed when continuing or stopping, regardless. You remember the example of Surah Al-Asr? إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. So if you begin with the word آمَنُوا, still you apply مَدُّ الْبَدَلِ حَرَكَتَيْن. If you connect it, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, he still apply مَدُّ الْبَدَلِ. The second is observed only when continuing the recitation. But when you stop, then مَدُّ الْبَدَلِ will be suspended. This mad, which is two harakas, would be suspended, such as the word وَإِلَيْهِ مَآب. If you stop, that develops a new rule, which is known as المد العارض للسكون. So if you choose to do 2, 4, or 6, then that overcomes the nature of مد البدل. المد العارض للسكون will be studied, inshallah, in the future in details. This verse, وَإِلَيْهِ مَآب, إِلَيْهِ أَدْعُو وَإِلَيْهِ مَآب, is verse number 36 of Surah Al-Ra'd. Now, the next case is that which is observed when stopping only. You see the previous one, which is when you continue the recitation only, not when you stop. But this one is the opposite. When you stop only, because if you connect this word, which has maddul badal, to the following word, it might develop a new hukm, especially if this word begins with hamza.
Yeah.
Such as, we have this example of Surah Yusuf, which says, وجاءوا. Where is مد البدل here? مد البدل is on the واو.
Yeah.
Because the مد letter, which is the واو, is preceded by
همزة.
So when you stop, then you prolong or you lengthen the واو to حركز because of مد البدل.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But what about that lengthening in the beginning when you said وَجَاءُ, that is مَدْ
وَاجِبْ
مُتَّصِلْ, because the مَدْ letter is followed by a hamza within the same word. Okay. So when I stop, there will be مَدْ الْبَدَلْ. I say وَجَاءُ, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
But guess what? If I continue the recitation and I connect it to the following word begins with
Hamza.
And there is a mad letter, so that will develop a new hukm, which is mad munfasil. And it is permissible to shorten it to 2 harakas, or tawassut to 4 harakas, or more than that, that is called ishba'. But now, in this case, if you choose to do it 4, as we agreed, we said that al-maddul ja' is a munfasil in our classes, we will lengthen it 4 counts. So, now I've got المد المنفصل, the separate مد, and I've got المد, مد البدل. Which one will overtake and overcome?
مد المنفصل.
المد المنفصل. So, if I normally prolong المد المنفصل 4 harakas, I will completely neglect مد البدل. Then I will say, وَجَاءُوا أَبَاهُمْ عِشَاءً يَبْكُونَ of Surah Yusuf, of course. That was the third case of
مد exchange
مد البدل, when it is observed when stopping only.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The fourth case is very amazing, that which is observed only when beginning with the word. Normally, we don't begin with any of these words. There is almost 7 words in the entire Quran, which fill in several surahs, not just 7 positions. These are 6 of them. If we begin with any of these words, there will be a different treatment. It will be even pronounced differently. Normally, we don't begin with these words. Let's take, for example, the first word. The first word, which is U'tumina. We do not read it this way. This is of verse number 283 of Surah Al-Baqarah. The ayah which is known as the longest ayah in the entire Quran. Yeah. Which is called what, Halim? Ayat al-Dayn. The ayah which is pertaining debt and dealing with loans. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْ أَمِنَ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا فَلْيُؤَدِّ الَّذِي اُؤْتُمِنَ أَمَانَتَهُ. Basically, this first alif, this first hamza is hamzat wasl. What does it mean? Hamzat wasl, or connecting hamza. When we connect this word to the previous one, we drop this hamza. We do not read it. But if you begin the word with it, then you must state it in saying, not in writing. So you say, O. Mm-hmm. Okay? And by the way, there is a very important trick. You may hear it from me for the first time, which is, what will determine the vowel on this hamza, the vowel on this alif, it doesn't have any vowel. It has a sign or a symbol that looks like the head of the sad. Similarly, in the entire Quran, hamzatul wasl, it will not have the hamza written as hamza. Rather, the symbol on top, like the head of the sad.
Yeah.
So how do I know that, whether it's fatha, dhamma, or kasra? How do I begin with it? What will determine that is the third letter of the word.
Yeah.
Look at the third letter of the word. That's ta. I don't mean the letter. I mean the vowel that
on
is
the
with the third letter of the word. So in this word, the third letter has dhamma. So that means hamzatul wasl, if I begin with it, I will pronounce the hamza with
dhamma.
Say it out loud. I want to make sure that you got it. Huh? I will pronounce the hamza with
dhamma.
So this hamza will not be hamzat wasl anymore. Rather, it will be hamzat qata'. I pronounce it clearly, even though I do not write it. And what kind of vowel will it take? The vowel of the third letter of the word. So in this case, it will be dhamma. And in order to apply maddul badal, I've got the first hamza. It will be stated in saying. And there is another hamza, but the second hamza is non-vowel. It has a sukun. And that's why the reciters have agreed that in this case, I'm going to exchange this hamza into a mad letter of the same type of the vowel of the first hamza. What is this complication? Tell me, how will I get to read it if I begin this word with the hamza? I will not connect it to the previous word. In this case, Halim, I gotta say, utumina. Utumina.
You don't pronounce the hamza.
Exactly, because I exchanged it into what? Into a mad letter, which is wow, that suits the dhamma of the first hamza. Because the second hamza was a sakina. Okay, next example.
Sheikh, utumina in hafs?
Yes, why? Because if you begin with it, normally, we never begin with this word.
Mm-hmm.
But we say, فَلْيُؤَدِّ الَّذِي اُتُمِنَ أَمَانَةَ. Okay? The next example as well. اِئْتِنَا. I've got two hamzas. The first one is hamzat wasl. I don't read it in case of connecting the word to the previous one. Continuing the recitation.
Mm-hmm.
But when I start with it, when I begin with it, then I state it in saying, not in writing. So I have to pronounce it. So yeah. I have to change the second hamza into
kasr.
A mad letter that suits the vowel of the first hamza, which is in this case, kasr.
Kasr.
In Surah Al-An'am, verse number 71. يَدْعُونَهُ إِلَى الْهُدَأْتِنَا يَدْعُونَهُ إِلَى الْهُدَأْتِنَا. I did not pronounce the first hamza. Rather, I did pronounce the second one. But when I begin with the word i'tina, then I will exchange the second hamza into a mad letter and I will say
i'tina.
Excellent. And I will say what?
i'tina.
With a mad that measures two counts. i'tina. Similarly, the next word, it will be idhalli. Idhalli. Changing the second hamza into a mad letter that suits the kasra, that will be ayah. I would say idhalli. But we do not in our regular recitation begin with this word. Rather we say, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ ذَلِّي وَلَا تَفْتِنِّي. Surah At-Tawbah, verse number 49.
Yeah, Shaykh, but the vowel here it's not kasra, it's fatha.
Which one?
Then the
excellent, not excellent observation. If the vowel of the third letter is fatha, still you give hamzat al-wasl if you want to pronounce it a kasra. This is a very excellent observation. Thank you so much. Okay. The next example of Surah Yunus, verse number 15.
قال الذين لا يرجون لقاءنا بقرآن غير هذا أو بدل.
The word ائتي. If I begin with it, I will say
ائتي بقرآن غير هذا,
which is not common, is not even known that much. But it will be مد بدل if I begin with any of these words. Now we can apply on the next couple of words. There are some cases that resemble the exchange مد. Even they don't meet the same criterion of مد البدل. Such as, when the original مد letter, if the original مد letter, which is not an alternative of the همزة, whether the همزة follows a non-vowel connected sound letter or not. What does it mean? The word قرآن, قرآن, we've got a مد letter, which is
الألف.
The ألف. Preceded by
همز.
همز. And the همز is preceded by a ساكن letter, which is راء. Whether the letter is ساكن or متحرك, vowel or non-vowel. But the مد letter is an original letter. It's not exchanged from a همزة. It is an original مد letter. The word قرآن spells as follows. Under any circumstances, قاف, راء, همزة, then ألف. And this ألف is a مد letter, original مد letter. Similarly, the next words, مسؤولة or الظمآن. And in the next line, we see the word ليأوس قنوط. The word ليأوس. The همزة is preceded by a vowel letter. This is what we meant above when we say whether the همزة is preceded by a ساكن
or
a vowel letter. So in this case, even though the مد letter is an original مد letter, is not an alternative of همزة, still will be similar, will be treated similar to مد البدل. Okay. We just studied these two examples when we said the مد letter follows a connecting همزة or همزة الوصل. So if I begin with it only, I will say either لي or
إيتي.
Right? Okay. There is another case that resembles the exchange مد or مد البدل. One word. That word, many people, whether Arab or non-Arab, confuse this word with another word. Look at this word, Ali. How long have you been a Muslim? I mean, you're Native American, right?
Yes, yeah.
Can you, after I finish this, give us an advice and give the reverts and give also those who are born Muslims an advice as how important it is to learn how to read the Quran and how easy it is since you're a revert yourself. And mashallah, even though your mother tongue was not Arabic, alhamdulillah, shukran, now you read the Quran properly and you're learning sophisticated rules of tajweed. So once I finish with this, inshallah, I'll let you speak to us. The word ata. وآت المال على حبه ذوي القربى. In Surah Al-Baqarah. The word آتا, which means give. This word will be treated similar to مد البدل. حركتين. آتا. There is مد letter preceded by همزة. Can you tell me, Halim, linguistically, what is the difference between the word آتا and آتا?
The ألف. So it was spelling, it's the
Let's begin with the meaning. The word ata means what?
He brought it. Someone.
Ata means gave.
Oh.
It is in the past tense. What about ata?
Means come.
He came with it.
Came, that's in the past tense as well. Ata amru Allah fala tasta'jilu. In the beginning of Surah An-Nahl, Allah says ata, ata. So how do you know this word is ata and this word is ata? As you said that they both begin with alif. In the word آتَ, I give مَدُّ الْبَدَلْ حَرَكَتَيْ in order to distinguish this word from the word آتَ, because this word, the ألف, is preceded by همزه. And the همزه will be written on the line before the ألف. In the case of the word آتَ, which means came. The همزه will be on top
of the ألف.
Of the ألف. Last case that's similar to مد البدل, the substitute مد. If you remember, we spoke about مد العوض, especially when the word ends with تنوين, then we stop adding the word. For instance, سواء. Am I stopping right? Nope. I said there should be مد عوض. Instead of التنوين, I will give natural مد حركتين.
Yeah.
So I will say سواء. Right?
Yeah.
Instead of التنوين. So in this case, when you stop like that, there is مد. مد عوض. And it is preceded by همزة. Mm-hmm. So that is similar also to مد البدل. خطأ similar to مد البدل. Brother Ali, after inshallah this short break, I want you to give us an advice and the viewers as well with regards to the importance of learning how to read the Quran, even though you are not born an Arabic speaker, you're Native American. Brothers and sisters, a short break, then inshallah we'll return back in a little bit. Please stay tuned. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Welcome to this new episode of Focus Point.
The new generation has the habit of reading more than before.
Jewish question was named basically the problem of Jews who lost their function in society.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. We promised you before the break that Brother Ali has something to share with us, so we're listening attentively. Please proceed on.
Learning the Quran in the language that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed it in is very, very important for all Muslims all throughout the world. It's a gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to mankind, and the Arabic-speaking people have gotten a blessing that some of them take for granted. But we as Muslims from all over the world, we need to learn this, because this will be the difference between the guidance, our guidance and our misguidance. If someone else translates it to you, then you misunderstand it or understand it according to how they understood or misunderstood the Quran. So it's very important. It's the language of the paradise. It's the language of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It's the language, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to reveal His message in. So we all need to strive hard to learn this language, and it can be done. You know, you have to take it step by step, and you have to make effort. But it definitely can be done. I remember when I first, you know, was trying to learn, it was extremely difficult. But alhamdulillah, you know, I made great effort, you know, and alhamdulillah, we're still learning and I'm still learning. But remember this, that the Quran is the hudan lil muttaqin, it's guidance for those who have taqwa, and the only way we can get the blessings and the guidance is by learning to read the Quran, to understand what Allah has said in the language that He has said it. And may Allah reward and assist us all in that effort.
Jazakumullah khair. So basically, it is not impossible for a non-Arabic speaker to learn how to read the Quran and also understand what he reads or what she reads.
No, it's not impossible. It's very important that we do.
May Allah make it easy for all of those who are sincere in the effort of learning the Quran to grasp on the knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah as well. Mm-hmm. Okay, now we're ready to practice, and I think we stopped last time at verse number 62. So we'll begin with verse number 63 of Surah Al-Kahf. That is page number 301, the Quran, the print of Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim.
Qala ara'ayta idh awayna ila as-sakhrati fa inni nasitu al-huta wa ma ansanihu illa ash-shaytanu an adhkura.
قال أرأيت إذ أوينا إلى الصخرة فإني نسيت الحوت وما أنسانيه إلا الشيطان أن أذكره
واتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا.
واتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا.
قال ذلك ما كنا نبغ
قال ذلك ما كنا نبغ
فارتدا على آثارهما قصصا
فارتدا على آثارهما قصصا
فوجدا عبدا من عبادنا آتيناه رحمة من عندنا
فوجدا عبدا من عبادنا آتيناه رحمة من عندنا
وعلمناه من لدنا علما
آتيناه رحمة من عندنا وعلمناه من لدنا علما
Before we go any further, let's study the ahkam and the rules which we meet in these three verses. In the first verse, قال أرأيت إذ أوينا إلى الصخرة
مد جائز
This is مد
جائز منفصل
مد جائز منفصل منفصل because the مد letter
in a word
fell in one word and the hams
next word
in a separate word which is the next word so why do we call it جائز because it is permissible to shorten it to two harakas or two prolong it to four five well then once again there is another مد جائز منفصل Where is it?
ما أنساني
وما أنسانيه Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If you notice here the word وما أنسانيه إلا الشيطان أن أذكره Look at the ها by the end of the word أنسانيه
مد الصلة
Does it fit the criterion of مد الصلة? Is this ha, the ha of the pronoun? Yes, it is.
Yeah, yes.
Right?
Yeah, but it doesn't fit because the...
Because of what?
The letter before
exactly.
ha is non-vowel.
The conditions for maddu sila that the ha of the pronoun should be preceded and followed by vowel
letters.
But in this case, it's preceded by a non-vowel letter. That's why there is no maddu sila, neither sora nor kubra here. But if you go to the word أذكره واتخذ there is definitely مد الصلة This ha of the pronoun I remember it It belongs to the third person And the previous letter and the following letter are
vowel
Okay واتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا Once again
سبيله
The word سبيله the ha is the ha of the pronoun preceded and followed by vowel letters. So this is مد الصلة. But what kind? The lesser connecting مد. جيد يا علف. بارك الله فيكم. Okay. The next ayah. قال ذلك ما كنا نبغ. There is a قلقلة on the ba. I prefer to connect it. So in this case, once I stop on any verse, I put the sukun. That's why I exchange the kasra of the word of the letter ghain into a sukun. I say nabagh. Now I will say قال ذلك ما كنا نبغ فارتدا على آثارهما قصصا. Again. مد جائز منفصل which we agreed to make it
four.
Okay. In verse number 65 فوجدا عبدا من عبادنا it's very obvious that we have إدغام with غنة we put a lot of emphasis on the غنة it should be two counts من عبادنا there is إظهار حقيقي من عبادنا آتيناه رحمة من عندنا من عبادنا آتيناه درز
مد جائز منفصل
مد جائز منفصل رحمة من عندنا we've got إضغام وإضغنة then إظهار من then عندنا can you remember عندنا what is ruling there
عندنا
The dal is not one of the letters which cause idgham if they follow a noon and sakina. That is ikhfa, haqiqi. عندنا ودغنا. Exactly. Okay. So that is ikhfa, haqiqi. وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا مِنْ لَدُنَّا What do we have there?
Idgham.
Idgham without غنا. It is never sufficient just to say idgham. You have to be specific. With غنا. Or without ghunna. Here it is idgham without ghunna. By the end of this episode, I ask Allah the Almighty to help us to understand what we've just learned and to benefit in our daily life with this knowledge and transmit it to others. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ This is all the time we got for you this episode and hope to meet you inshallah next time safely. I'll leave you in peace. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ
Brothers and sisters, to increase your iman, read the miracle, recite the Quran. Recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Quran are all Muslims' pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span. Sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation. We were chosen to be part of his nation. He gave us a message, and that was Islam. So read this miracle, recite the Quran.